हेलो,
हाँ, गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम। आई वेलकम यू ऑल मैम फॉर दिस गेट लेक्चर एंड आई वेलकम ऑल स्टूडेंट्स फॉर टुडेज क्लास। इन टुडेज क्लास मैम विल बी फोकस्ड ऑन हाइड्रोलिक्स। सो आई रिक्वेस्ट ऑल स्टूडेंट्स प्लीज पे अटेंशन ड्यूरिंग द लेक्चर। आफ्टर द लेक्चर मैडम विल बी देयर फॉर क्वेश्चन आंसरिंग सेशन। एंड मैम थैंक यू सो मच फॉर योर वैल्यूएबल टाइम। नाउ
थैंक यू।
मैम यू कैन स्टार्ट विथ योर लेक्चर।
ओके, थैंक यू मैडम for giving me this opportunity to give this expert talk on the channel hydraulics. Today's topic is channel hydraulics. Good afternoon everyone. Rajendra, Bhagyashri, Omkar, Achal, are you there?
Yes ma'am, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Okay, so this is my second lecture. I think my first lecture would be beneficial to you, and this will also be beneficial to you from gate point of view. Okay. So in 1 hour we can just revise the topic. We cannot go in detail because there are many subtopics in the head of one topic. Okay, so quickly we will go, or we will touch all the subtopics or subheads given to me. Okay, so let us start with this channel hydraulics. What is this channel hydraulics? Or first we'll see what are the contents. Today we'll learn, that is flow measurement in channels and pipes, open channel, then types of open channel and flow, then channel geometry, then energy depth relationship, types of flow, specific energy, then water surface profiles or slope profiles, and hydraulic jump. Okay. So let us see what is this open channel. Open channel are natural or man-made conveyance structure. Clear? Man-made or natural conveyance structure which has a free surface at atmospheric pressure. We have common examples: rivers, then streams, then stormwater sewers, then these sewers may flowing partially or in full. So there are different types of open channel. It may be as per the shape is considered. It may be trapezoidal, it may be rectangular, it may be circular or triangular. Okay, or if you see its different what are the different types of streams? It may be flume. What is flume? Flume is a channel made up of wood or metal or concrete, which is supported on or above to carry out the water across a depression. That is known as flume. Okay. Then what is chute? Do you know chute? What is chute or shoot? It is a channel having steep slope. Then what is drop? It is a similar type of chute, but the change in elevation is effected in a short distance. This is for short distance. Then we have culvert. When it is partially full, it is covered channel installed to drain out water through highways or railways embankment. Okay, so these are some of the examples of the open channel. Then next is, what is prismatic and non-prismatic channel? A channel in which the cross-sectional shape, then size and bottom slope, these are constant, then it is known as prismatic channel. All the natural channels which we commonly called as nala, these are having varying cross section. Rivers have varying cross sections. Therefore, these are known as non-prismatic channels. So most of the man-made channels are prismatic channels over long stretch. These are of rectangular, trapezoidal, triangular or circular in shape. So these are actually a man-made channels. These are called as prismatic channels, having same cross-sectional area or shape, size and bottom slope. Clear? Then we have rigid and mobile boundary channels. What are these rigid and mobile channels? These rigid channels are those in which the boundary is not deformable. Boundary is constant. So shape and roughness magnitudes are not functions of flow parameters. Shape and roughness magnitudes are not functions of flow parameters. We can have examples of this rigid channel as lined canals. You have heard about this lined channel. Lined means the liners are provided on the canals. So these are the examples of rigid channel or non-erodible unlined channel. This may be a rigid channel. Okay. So in rigid channel, the flow velocity and shear stress distribution, flow velocity and shear stress distribution will be such that no major scoring or erosion or deposition will take place in the channel. That means the channel geometry and the roughness are essentially constant with respect to time. Okay, so this is about the rigid channel. So when the boundary of the channel is mobile, it carries considerable amount of sediments and suspension through suspension, then such channels are known as mobile channel. Since they carry the sediments through it, there is erosion of the sides of the channel. Therefore, their shape may change, size may change. Therefore, it is known as mobile channel. So, in mobile channel, not only depth of the flow, but also bed width, longitudinal slope of the channel may undergo changes with space and time depending on the type of flow. Okay. So the resistance to flow, quantity of sediments transported and channel geometry all depends on the interaction of flow with the channel boundaries. So in general, a mobile boundary channel can be considered to have 4-degree freedom. Okay. Mobile boundary channel can be considered to have 4-degree freedom, because all the things are goes on changing, and in rigid channel we have 1 degree of freedom. Its shape, size, cross sectional area is always constant, even the slope is constant in rigid channel. Clear? So this is about rigid and mobile boundary channel. Then we have flow regimes, steady and unsteady flow, uniform and non-uniform flow. So there are different flows, that is known as flow regime. So what is steady and unsteady flow? So when flow properties such as depth or discharge at a section do not change with time, depth or discharge do not change with time is known as steady flow. That means if the depth or discharge changes with time, the flow is termed as unsteady. So flood flows in river or rapidly varying flow in canals are some of the examples of unsteady flow. Okay. Then next is uniform and non-uniform flow. So if flow properties, say depth of flow in the open channel, remain constant along the length of the channel, then the flow is said to be uniform. Okay. And the flow in which flow properties vary, flow property is nothing but the depth or discharge. Okay. If it varies along the channel, then it is term as non-uniform flow. So for if we consider example of uniform flow, so prismatic channel, just we have seen, so prismatic channel carrying a certain discharge with a constant velocity is an example of uniform flow. In uniform flow, the gravity force on a flowing liquid balances the frictional force between flowing fluid and inside surface of the channel, which is in contact with the fluid. Okay. And in case of non-uniform flow, the friction and gravity force are not in balance. Therefore, it is non-uniform. Here you can see the figure, uniform flow through open channel. So depth is constant throughout the length. That is known as uniform flow. Then we have gradually varied flow and rapid varying flow. So the non-uniform flow is classified as gradually varied flow and rapidly varied flow. So varied flow assumes that no flow is externally added or taken out of the channel system. So volume of the water in known time interval is conserved in the channel system. Okay. So if a change of depth in varied flow is gradual, if change of depth in varied flow is gradual, so that the curvature of streamline is not excessive, then such flow is known as gradually varied flow. Okay. Here in figure you can see the gradually varied flow. So if a curvature in a varied flow is large and the depth changes appreciably over short length, such phenomena is known as rapidly varied flow. The figure is of gradually varied flow. Gradually varied flow means what? If the change of depth in a varied flow is gradual, so that a curvature of streamline is not excessive. So in gradually varied flow, the loss of energy is essentially due to boundary friction. Okay. Therefore, the distribution of pressure in the vertical direction may be taken as hydrostatic. That is known as hydrostatic pressure. Okay. So this is about gradually and rapidly varied flow. Then we have, next is spatially varied flow. Spatially varied flow means if some flow is added or subtracted from the system, then the resulting varied flow is spatially varied flow. It can be steady or unsteady. So in steady, spatially varied flow, the discharge while being steady varies along the channel length. So here example is the flow over a side wear. Side wear jo hota hai, it is constructed to overflow the or flow the excess water from a reservoir. That is known as wear. So flow over a side wear is an example of steady flow. Okay. So this is third type of varied flow, that is spatially varied flow. Then next part is the channel geometry. The term channel section means cross section of a channel taken normal to the direction of flow. Normal means perpendicular to the direction of flow. So the vertical channel section is a vertical section passing through the lowest or bottom section. Okay. So natural channel sections are very irregular in shape, whereas artificial channels are usually designed with sections of regular geometry shapes. Okay. So usually the trapezoid is a common shape. It may be rectangular, it may be triangular. These are special cases of trapezoidal. Since rectangle has two vertical sides, it is commonly used for channels built for the stable material such as lined masonry, rock, metal, timber. So these are the from this material we can construct rectangular channels. Okay. The depth of flow y is the vertical distance of water surface to the lowest point of the channel section. That means this stage is the elevation or vertical distance of the pre-surface above the datum. Then we have a term T, top width. Top width is the width of the natural section at the water surface. Then A capital A is called water area, which is the cross sectional area of the flow measured normal to the direction of the flow. Then weighted perimeter is denoted by capital P, which is the length of the line of intersection of the channel weighted surface with the cross sectional plane normal to the direction of the plane. Weighted means jitna part water surface mein covered hua hai, that is weighted perimeter. Then hydraulic radius R is the ratio of water area to its weighted perimeter. So R is equal to A by P. Then we have hydraulic depth D, the ratio of water area to the top width. D is equal to A by T. Then we have Z, section factor. This is for critical flow computation. It is the product of water area and the square root of hydraulic depth. Square root of hydraulic depth. Okay. So in case of uniform flow, the section factor Z is equal to 2 by 3. Okay. So this is the rectangular channel. How we can calculate the area? It has length and breadth, or you can see here the width B and Y depth, breadth and depth. So area is equal to B into Y. Perimeter will be B, it is weighted perimeter, so B plus twice Y. And top width is B, and hydraulic radius R is given by A by P, weighted area upon weighted perimeter. So it is B into Y divided by B plus 2Y. Then for triangular channel, depth is Y. Sides, for since it is triangular slopy portion, we have side slope one, M is to 1, where M is horizontal dimension and 1 is the vertical dimension. So from this slope, we can calculate area as M into Y square. Perimeter is equal to 2Y under root M 1 plus M square. So sometimes the notations may be different. Instead of M, N can be used, small n can be used. So top width we can calculate as calculated as twice M into Y, and hydraulic radius is M into Y divided by 2 under root 1 plus M square. Then for trapezoidal channel, it is divided into, sorry, one rectangle and two triangles. Okay, so its area is B plus MY into Y, where M is the horizontal slope, one is M is to 1. Then P is B plus 2Y under root 1 plus M square, and top width will be B plus 2MY. Okay. So here the calculations are mathematical calculations. You can do it. How MY, twice MY is added. Then radius B plus MY into Y divided by B plus twice Y under root 1 plus M square. So this is for trapezoidal channel. And these formulae are very, very important, because most of the channels are of shape trapezoid. Then what is specific energy? Specific energy is the energy head relative to the channel bottom, which is expressed in terms of flow depth and velocity head. It is the addition of flow depth and the velocity head. When the channel slope is small, then the specific energy is given by E, which is equal to Y plus V square by 2G. Here, water surface depth, water surface or water depth is given YA. So, it will become YA plus V square by 2G. If the bottom slope is large, then the formula is different. E is equal to Y cos theta plus V square by 2G, where theta is the slope of the bottom slope of the channel. If slope is small, then we can use this formula, E is equal to Y plus V square by 2G. If the slope is high or large, then it is Y cos theta plus V square by 2G. Then the relationship between Q and Y, discharge and depth, is given by Q square is equal to twice GY square E minus Y. Okay. So when the depth of flow is plotted against the specific energy for a given channel section and discharge, a specific curve is obtained. This is shown in figure. Okay. So here, for a specific energy, two possible depths will get. There are two top possible gates, depths y1 and y2. So these are called as alternate depths. So minimum specific energy corresponds to the critical state of flow. Minimum specific energy corresponds to the critical state of flow. Then at the critical state, two alternate depths apparently become one, and that is known as critical depth. Okay. So at critical depth, the specific energy is minimum. Okay. So when depth of the flow is greater than a critical depth, then the velocity of flow is less than critical velocity of for the given discharge. And hence it is known as subcritical flow or subcritical depth. When the depth of flow is less than critical depth, then flow is supercritical. Okay. So the critical flow is the critical state of flow, which is defined as the condition for which the Proud's number is equal to unity, 1. Proud's number is 1. Okay. So here it is written, for critical flow, Proud number is 1. So the more common definition is that the state of flow at which specific energy is minimum for a given discharge, that is known as critical flow. So when depth of flow of water over certain reach of a given channel is equal to critical depth YC, that the flow is known as critical flow. So critical slope is another term. Slope is such that the normal flow occurs with the Proud's number F equal to 1. So smallest critical shape or slope of a specified channel shape, discharge, and roughness is termed as limiting slope. Smallest critical slope for a specified channel, for a specified channel shape, or specified discharge or roughness is known as limiting slope. So by adjusting the slope and discharge, critical flow may be obtained at a given normal depth. Okay. So equation for specific energy in channel of a small slope with alpha is equal to 1 is written as y is equal to q square upon twice g a square. This is the formula for the specific energy. So the critical state of flow, so at critical state of flow, the velocity head is equal to half of hydraulic depth. Velocity head is equal to half of hydraulic depth. So the flow at or near the critical state is unstable. This is because a minor change in specific energy at or close to the critical state will cause a major change in depth. So it is observed also that when the flow is near or near the critical state, the water surface appears unstable and wavy. Such phenomena is generally caused by the minor changes in energy due to variation in the channel roughness, cross section and slope, or it may be deposits of sediments. So in the design of channel, if depth is found at or near the critical depth for a great length of channel, the shape or slope of the channel should be altered in order to secure a greater stability. Okay. So when depth of the flow in the channel is greater than critical depth, y is greater than yc, or Froude's number is less, then it is known as subcritical flow or streaming flow. Subcritical flow or streaming flow. Then when depth of flow in the channel is less than critical depth, or Froude's number is greater than 1, then it is known as supercritical or shooting flow. This is known as shooting flow. I think some part, one or two slides are missing here. So, okay. We can further calculate the critical flow. So here Q represents the discharge per unit width of the channel section. So total discharge Q passing through the rectangular channel of bottom width B is expressed as capital Q upon B. Sorry, small q is equal to capital Q upon B. Small q is the discharge per unit width of the channel. So what will be capital Q? It is small q into B. So from earlier example, earlier computation, Here you can see the formulae for uniform flow or for computation of critical flow. We can get this formulae. So this will not cover. So for rectangular shape, the minimum specific energy is calculated as 3/2 critical depth YC. This is the formula for calculation of the minimum specific energy. Then, what is qualification of uniform flow? So first, it should have the depth, water area, velocity and discharge at every section of the channel constant. This is the qualification of uniform flow. Depth, water area, velocity and discharge at every section of the channel must be constant. Then the energy line, water surface and channel bottom, energy line, water surface and channel bottom are parallel to their slopes. All are parallel. And it can be written as SF is equal to SW, which is equal to SO or S, where SO is the slope of channel. So this should be same. Water slope, then energy line slope should be equal, constant, same. Then uniform flow has constant velocity at every point on the channel section. The flow depth in uniform flow is known as normal depth. Okay, so it is other than critical depth. So the flow depth in the channel is known as normal depth. This uniform flow is always steady flow and it will be developed if resistance is balanced by gravity forces. This uniform flow will be developed if resistance is balanced by the gravity force. So how we can measure the velocity? So there are two formulae, Manning's equation and Chase's formula. So here, Manning's equation is V is equal to 1 by N, R square, R to the power 2 by 3, S to the power half. So where V, mean velocity is V, R is the hydraulic radius and S is the slope of the energy line. And small n is the coefficient of roughness. So your Chase's formula is missing. So V is equal to under root R into S. It is the formula of Chase's formula. V is equal to under root RS. Now, we'll see what is most economical section. So it is known that the conveyance of channel section increases with the increase in the hydraulic radius or with decrease in the weighted perimeter. Hydraulic radius kab increase hoga? Jab weighted perimeter decrease hoga. At that, then only the conveyance in the channel section increases. Okay. So from hydraulic point of view, the channel section having least weighted perimeter for a given area has the maximum conveyance. Least weighted perimeter has the maximum conveyance. Such sections are known as based hydraulic sections. Okay. So of all the possible open channels, semicircular shape has the least amount of perimeter for a given area. But in actual practice, the shape is not in use. So the common shape we used is the trapezoidal section. We can see here calculation of rectangular section and trapezoidal section. So here we have already seen what is B, Y, then perimeter, how it is calculated. R is equal to BY upon B plus 2Y. Okay. So after, if P is minimum, P means weighted perimeter is minimum, A is constant, area is constant. So dp by dy is equal to 0, or a by y square plus 2 is equal to 0. From perimeter we have calculated this. So this equation gives a is equal to 2yc square. Yc is the critical depth. So width is calculated as 2 into yc, or r radius, hydraulic radius is calculated as yc upon 2. This is the formula. If you put these values of a, we can get r is equal to yc upon 2 and b is equal to 2 into yc. So this is the condition for the most economical section. Then for trapezoidal section, we have this formulae. Then keeping A and M as fixed, and for minimum weighted perimeter, A is constant. So from that we'll get R equal to yc upon 2 and m is equal to 1 by under root 3. So E here denotes a hydraulically efficient structure, hydraulically efficient section, sorry. So for hydraulically most efficient trapezoidal section is 1/2 of the rectangular hexagon, 1/2 of the rectangular hexagon, and the dimension of hydraulically efficient trapezoidal section will be such that a semicircle can be inscribed in it. So this is known as most efficient section. Then we'll see what are the water surface profiles. What is this water surface profile? It is a measure of how the flow depth changes longitudinally. How the flow depth changes longitudinally. The profiles are classified based on the relationship between actual water depth and normal water depth and critical depth. Okay. Y, Yn and Yc. Actual water depth, normal depth and critical depth. So what is this normal depth? Is the depth of flow that would occur if flow was uniform and steady. For this ideal condition, when the flow was uniform and steady. For that condition, the depth of flow is known as normal depth. And what is critical depth? It is the depth of flow where energy is at a minimum for a particular discharge. Okay. So we have just seen for maximum discharge, the weighted perimeter should be minimum. From that weighted perimeter, we have calculated the dimensions, width and radius, hydraulic radius. So critical depth is defined as the depth of flow where energy is at a minimum. So when energy is minimum, normal depth is equal to critical depth. So there are certain slopes. So in order to classify the surface profile, it is necessary to identify the type of channel bottom slope. It is denoted by SO, whether it is mild slope or whether it is critical slope, steep slope, horizontal slope or adverse slope. We'll see one by one. So what is this mild slope? It is denoted by capital M. So criteria for mild slope is that YN is greater than YC, means normal depth is greater than critical depth, and it is a sustaining slope that is falling in the direction of the flow. Falling in the direction of the flow. Similarly, critical slope, here in critical slope, YN is equal to YC. It is again a sustaining slope that is in the direction of the flow. Then we have steep slope where YC is greater than YN. Critical depth is greater than normal depth. Or YN is less than YC. This is again a sustaining slope that is falling in the direction of the flow. Then fourth one is the horizontal slope denoted by H. Horizontal hai, this is plane. So slope will be zero, S will be zero. So since it is plane, normal depth will not exist. This is known as non-sustaining slope. Then for adverse slope, ulta rahega. SO is less than zero. So it is again a non-sustaining slope. YN does not exist. So these are the five types of slopes occurring in the prismatic channel. We have already seen what is prismatic channel. So here again there are three types of representations of water profiles for each type of slope. Okay, so entire region above the channel bottom is divided into three parts or three zones by drawing two lines. First is the bottom slope, above that there is a critical depth line CDL, above that there will be normal depth line YN, NDL. Okay, critical depth line and normal depth line, clear? So zone 1, that is between bottom slope and critical zone 1 is the bottom slope and critical depth line. Then zone 2 is the region lying between the uppermost line and the line next to it. Sorry, zone 1 and zone 3 we have changed. Zone 1 is the region lying above the uppermost line. Okay. Then zone 2 is the region lying between uppermost and next line, that is CDL. And zone 3 is the region between middle line and the channel bed line. Middle lines mean CDL and channel bed line. Okay. So when YN is greater than YC, the slope will be of M1 shape. Then second profile will be when flow is in between NDL and CDL. So it will be like this. And third is the M3. So these three types of slopes or profiles will be given for each type of slope. When now critical slope. Critical slope means what? Normal depth is equal to critical depth. So again, there are three types. First one is the above NDL or CDL, and second one will be parallel to it, and third one will be below that. So these are the profiles. We'll see for horizontal adverse slope. So from this we can conclude that only 12 water surface profiles are possible. You can see here, you can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So for these 5 types of slopes, only 12 surface profiles are possible. So water surface profiles which are lying in zone 1 and 3 are called as backwater curves. The surface profiles which are lying in zone 1 and 3 are called as backwater curves, and those which are lying in zone 2 are called as draw water curves. Okay. So the hydraulic curve classifications are used to describe the shape of the water surface profile at a specific flow. The curves are based on the hydraulic slope and the relative position of the actual flow depth to normal and critical depth. These are designated as 1, 2, 3. So these are slopes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. These are 12 types of profiles. So this here you can see wear hai to kaisa slope aayega, overflow hai to kaisa slope aayega, underflow hai to kaisa, that defines the this surf water profile gives the shape of a water curve or level of the water. After this, we'll see what is hydraulic jump, a phenomena in which the flow passes suddenly from supercritical to subcritical flow. Supercritical to subcritical flow, causing distinct rise or jump of the water. That is also known as standing wave. And this hydraulic jump is the example of rapidly varied flow. We have seen what is gradually varying flow and rapidly varying flow. So this typical example of rapidly varying flow is the hydraulic jump. This is hydraulic jump. You can commonly see where the if you have visited the dam structure, when the gates are open, then you will find the hydraulic jump. So LJ is the length of hydraulic jump. When the depth of flow changes supercritical to subcritical, then it is known as hydraulic jump. So these are the possible locations where hydraulic jump may occur. So first one is the steep slope meets mild or horizontal slope. When steep slope meets horizontal slope, then hydraulic jump may occur. Or when the steep slope meeting to adverse slope. एडवर्स स्लोप है तो भी हाइड्रोलिक जंप हो सकता है. हाइड्रोलिक जंप मीन्स अ टर्बुलेंस ऑफ वाटर व्हिच इज क्रिएटेड ड्यू टू द डिफरेंस इन द स्लोप. एंड व्हेन हम्प इज प्रोवाइडेड ऑन द स्टीप स्लोप. स्टीप स्लोप है एंड इन बिटवीन दैट स्लोप हम्प इज प्रोवाइडेड, देन अगेन हाइड्रोलिक जंप मे बी अकर. these are some situations where the jump is possible or occur. So whenever steep slope meets mild steep or adverse slope, just we have seen figures. On the downstream side of the sluice gate, I have already told you, when the reservoir is full and the gates of dam are open, and that time you will find the hydraulic jump. On the upstream side, where hump is provided on the steep slope. So reason why we create the hydraulic jump. So to reduce the speed of the water, which is to be disposed off to the downstream side after producing the electrical energy. Then to reduce the scoring or sedimentation or deposition of loose material in the river. Therefore, the hydraulic jump is created. So there are some different types of hydraulic jump, which are based on the Froude's number. What is Froude's number? It is the square root of inertia force to the gravitational force. Ratio of square root of inertia force to the gravitational force. So when the Froude numbers in between 1 to 1.5, then it is called as undular jump. When 1.5 to 2.5, it is weak jump. For the range of 2.5 to 4.5, it is called as oscillating jump. Then for 4.5 to 9 Froude's number, it is steady jump. And above these 9 and above, this jump is known as strong jump. We'll see in detail. This is the sketch. This is undular jump when Froude number is in 1 to 1.7. So here the water surface shows slight undulations and the jump is called undular jump. Then second one is the weak jump. The smaller rollers are developed in the water surface, although the downstream water surface remains smooth. Here the energy loss is very low. Then oscillating jump. Froude number ranges from 2.5 to 4.5. Okay. So jet entering the jump oscillates from bottom to top and back again at a irregular period. So the irregular waves which travel a long distance are produced, and these waves may cause considerable damage to the banks of the channel. Okay. Then steady jump is 4.5 to 9 for Froude's number, 4.5 to 9. This jump is steady, it is well balanced, occurs at the same location, and the position of the jump is not affected by the downstream water level. Energy loss ranges from 45% to 70%. Then last one is the strong jump, having Froude number more than 9 or more. So the jump surface is very rough and continues for a long distance, and the energy dissipation can be up to 85% from this strong jump. Okay. So this is about the hydraulic jump. Now we'll see the practical applications of the hydraulic jump. It is used for energy dissipator or to dissipate the energy of water flowing over the dams or weirs and prevent the scoring on the downstream side. There it is used to increase the discharge through a sluice or gates by holding the backwater. Then it is used to increase the water depth on the apron and thus reduce the uplift pressure. these hydraulic jumps are used to raise the water level in irrigation canals, which increases the command. Then it is used for aeration and dechlorination of wastewater. It is again used to remove the air pockets from the water supply pipes, and it is used to mix the chemicals thoroughly in the water treatment plants. Okay, mix kab hoga chemical? When there is a turbulence, and this turbulence is nothing but the water jump. Okay, so these are some of the practical examples of the hydraulic jump. So thank you very much for your patient listening. Is there any question?
Students, if you are having any question,
no, ma'am.
You can ask.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Shall I leave the meeting?
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your valuable time.
Thank you. Madam, please send some screenshot of this lecture if you have taken, or you can take now. Shefali, madam.
Yes, ma'am.
Have you taken some screenshot?
Yes, yes, ma'am. Already taken.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am.
Please send me 2-3 snaps.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Thank you.